The time period we have covered so far is the time period from the Great Flood until the end of the Old Kingdom of Egypt, and also the end of the Akkadian Kingdom. This same time period is covered in four chapters of the book of Genesis, chapters 8 to 11. The book of Genesis is the first book in the Bible. It's also the first book in the Torah. This book was dictated by God to Moses on the mountain, 900 years before these events took place. It is important to remember that God is summarizing the past to Moses to set the record straight about the history of Israel, because God, after they have gone into captivity and slavery, has called Moses to lead them out of captivity. And he is now forming the nation of Israel in Moses' time. So he's giving Israel, the nation, their history. God is founding this nation of Israel in order to show himself to the rest of the world. We have been looking at secular history for this time period, but now we must shift gears into the biblical history. The first seven chapters of Genesis cover the pre-flood time period. It's the creation of the world, the Garden of Eden, Cain and Abel, Enoch, and the flood of Noah. The flood of Noah is a good place to start our study because it coincides with known history. We will study the pre-flood parts later on after we have gathered all of the data. Beginning in Genesis chapter 8, verse 4, we read that Noah's ark came to rest on Mount Ararat. Mount Ararat is a real place in eastern Turkey. It has an elevation of 5,140 meters. In feet, that's 16,850 feet. It's just south of the Caucasus Mountains. Today, there is actually an archaeological site on Mount Ararat studying what is thought to be Noah's ark. In the photo, you see the shape of the ark in the foreground and Mount Ararat in the background on the left. You can see a rib down the center line of the ship in the foreground. You can also see the hydropoles along a highway through the middle of the picture. In the King James Bible, when reading the Hebrew text, the Old Testament, the Hebrew word for God's name, Jehovah, is interpreted as Lord in all capital letters. Whenever you see that, L-O-R-D, in all caps, it is actually the tetragrammaton, which means four letters, Y-H-W-H. This is the name of God in Hebrew, which is most often translated into English as Jehovah. As we read chapter 8, we find that when the ark comes to rest, God says to Noah, "Breed abundantly and fill the earth." Then Noah offered a sacrifice to Jehovah, which was the normal custom in the ancient world and was pleasing to him. Noah offered one of every clean beast. Noah did distinguish between clean and unclean animals for offering. This was likely a custom of Noah carried on since Abel offered the firstling of the flock. God then says some very important things for us to understand. In Genesis chapter 8, verse 21 and 22, God says, "I will not again curse the ground any more for man's sake. For the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I again smite any more every living thing as I have done. While the earth remaineth, seed time and harvest, and cold and heat, and summer and winter, and day and night shall not cease." End quote. When God says, "not again," he is referring back to a time when he actually did curse the ground for man's sake. Let's look at the curse that God placed upon Adam in the Garden of Eden when he disobeyed God. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 17 to 19, "And unto Adam he said, Because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree which I commanded thee, saying, Thou shalt not eat of it, cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. thorns and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. For out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. End quote. Now in chapter 8 of Genesis, God is making a change after the flood when he says, I will not again curse the ground anymore for man's sake. God here promised us that the seasons and harvest will continue as long as the earth continues. No more will the ground bring up only thorns and thistles for us when we till it. We will now have a harvest season. God has removed that curse upon the ground, which lasted from Adam to the flood. During that time, man was to eat the herb of the field. They were merely gatherers and grazers, or as scientists call them, hunter-gatherers. They were now going to be farmers with a seed time and a harvest time. In chapter 9, verse 2 to 4, he puts the fear of man into every animal and allows the eating of meat for men with the stipulation that blood not be eaten. Quote, and the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every fowl of the air, upon all that moveth upon the earth and upon all the fishes of the sea. Into your hand they are delivered. Every moving thing that liveth shall be meat for you. Even as the green herb, I have given you all things. But the flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, you shall not eat. End quote. This is a big change from pre-flood times. Men were declared vegetarian in the Garden of Eden, as we read in Genesis chapter 1, verse 29 and 30. And God said, Behold, I have given you every herb-bearing seed which is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree, and which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed. To you it shall be for meat, and to every beast of the earth, and to every fowl of the air, and to every living thing that creepeth upon the earth, wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for meat. And it was so. End quote. Now, after the flood, he is allowing every moving thing that lives to be food for man, even as the herb. But the fear of man is upon them, as it was not before. He then makes a rule that whoever sheds man's blood, by man his blood shall be shed, because man was made in God's image. There were most likely people on the earth eating flesh and killing each other before the flood, but just as today, who does what God says? There are always those who break the rules. God has altered the rules from the time before the flood to allow meat eating and hunting and giving the animals a natural fear of man as a predator. Eating blood, however, was strictly forbidden because the life is in the blood. God then establishes a covenant between him and all flesh that he will never destroy them again by flood. He also offers the rainbow as a token of this promise, that whenever it rains, the rainbow will be present as a token of this promise. There is no way this covenant can be broken by mankind or by angels. He just gave his word that it would be so. There are three major events recorded in the Bible, which we still need to cover for our time period: the curse of Canaan, the table of nations, and the Tower of Babel. It will be easier to follow if we first look at the Table of Nations and then look at the other two after. First of all, we will see how the children of Japheth, Ham, and Shem spread out over the earth. There has been a lot of work done to identify all of these ancient nations. Some of them can easily be identified by historical or cultural evidence, but some, even though they become important figures in later prophecies, can only be speculated about as to their true identity. Chapter 10 of Genesis has been named the Table of Nations by Bible students because it names the nations that came out of the sons of Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. These are the first nations to populate the earth after the flood. The important thing here is that God does not name all the nations and all their sons, by generation, he only highlights the important ones for us to understand. This is the history of Israel and its neighbors as they relate to Israel. He tells us a little about some of them, which we will look at. We'll do these in the order that they appear in the 10th chapter of Genesis. The entire 10th chapter of Genesis is all family tree, but we have put it into a graph form to look at it easier. And we will begin with the sons of Japheth. Japheth had 7 sons. Only 2 of them, Gomer and Javan, had sons mentioned here, even though all of them fathered great nations. God is showing some things to Israel about their neighbors, things that are important for Israel to understand. Gomer is widely associated with the Cimmerians, an ancient nation which populated the Pontic steppe on the northern shores of the Black Sea, who migrated down through the Caucasus Mountains and battled with the Assyrians in the 7th century BC. Gomer is identified by Josephus, the 1st century Jewish historian, as the forefather of the Galatians of the Anatolian Peninsula. The Galatians were actually called Gomerites, but were named Galatian by the conquering Greeks. Galatia was actually pre-settled by the Celts or Gauls of Europe, which may still be related to the ancient Cimmerians anyway. Madai is said to be the forefather of the Medes by Josephus, as well as several other sources. The Medes were a key player in the battles over Mesopotamia of later times. The Kurds, who were just allied with the USA in Iraq against ISIS, are now fighting against Turkey in Syria. The Kurds also carry traditions of themselves being the descendants of Madai and the Medes. Javan is claimed by the Greeks as the forefather of their ancestors, Ionia, Mycenae, Doria, and Minoa. Tubal is associated by Josephus with the ancient Iberian, who today populate Georgia, Italy, and Spain. Meshech is associated with Armenia, Georgia, and Anatolia. A group of them seem to have migrated into Anatolia after the fall of the Hittite Empire, as they are mentioned in the Assyrian libraries, but not in the Hittites. Josephus identified Tiras as the Thracians, an Indo-European tribe of southeastern Europe who founded the city of Thrace. Gomer's sons are mentioned. Ashkenaz is a bit of a mind-bender. In all of the Table of Nations, Ashkenaz is the firstborn son of the firstborn son of the firstborn son of Noah. In Jewish literature, Ashkenaz was associated with the Scythians, then the Slavic nations, who migrated into the Rhineland in Germany and, accepting Judaism, became the Ashkenazi Jews. I don't know anything about the Ashkenazi Jews, but by bloodline, Jews are children of Shem, while Japheth is the father of Gentiles. It is possible for Gentiles to convert to Judaism, but today we are talking about bloodlines. There may be Slavic people who are related to the Ashkenazi as well. Assyrian records speak of the Ashkuza, a tribe who expelled the Cimmerians from Armenia. Riphath is associated with the Paphlagonia region of Anatolia by Josephus and by Greek mythology as the people of the Riphian Mountains, a legendary mountain which may have been the Caucasus Mountains. The modern Armenians call themselves the House of Togarma. The nation of Georgia also claims strong ties to Togarma. Magog is associated with the Scythians by Josephus. There are many theories about who Magog is, because they become an important figure in the apocalyptic prophecies. Gomer is mentioned in the book of Ezekiel, along with Magog, Tubal, Meshech, and Togarma, as a company of nations under a leader named Gog, who will attack God's people and be opposed by God himself. This great battle is reiterated in the book of Revelation as the great nation which rises up against God's people in the end times at Armageddon. The sons of Jovan are said to have populated the isles around the Aegean Sea. Jovan is the name used by the Hebrews to describe the Greeks, the Ionians specifically, who are the people populating the islands of the Aegean Sea and the mainland surrounding it. It is generally understood that the Isles of the Nations is actually the Greek Isles, including the Cyprus and Crete. In later prophecy, we learn that these are a seafaring people. The ships of Tarshish and the ships of Kittim play a leading role in later prophecies. Tarshish is a legendary long-lost city, one of the merchants who traded with the port city of Tyre to provide metals to Solomon of silver, iron, tin, and lead. This is revealed in the prophecy of doom over Tyre in the 27th chapter of Ezekiel, which also tells Tyre, in the 6th verse, "The company of the Ashurites, who have made thy benches of ivory, brought out of the isles of Kittim," meaning Kittim is an island nation, somewhere in the Aegean or Mediterranean Sea. Dodanim is strongly associated with the Isle of Rhodes by Jewish history and Greek history. The Dodanese people inhabited a large group of islands all around Rhodes Island. In the King James Bible, the word Goyim is translated as Gentiles, which means non-Jew in modern terms. A more accurate translation is nations, all nations, including the Jewish nation. After the table of nations lists out all the children of Japheth and their families, ending with the sons of Javan, he says, "By these were the isles of the Gentiles divided in their lands, every one after his tongue, after their families in their nations." This is all he said of the entire bloodline of Japheth. The ancient Hebrew people referred to the people surrounding the Aegean Sea as Javan. There are thousands of islands in the Aegean Sea. The Isles of the Gentiles in this passage seems to be referring directly to the isles of one specific group of Gentiles who populated the isles of the Aegean Sea, the sons of Javan. The sons of Japheth are closely associated with the Caucasus Mountains. This is where we get the word Caucasian. They seem to have migrated west and east from the Caucasus Mountains to populate Europe, Russia, and Iran. Scientists call these the Indo-European tribes. Now, the family line of Ham is very rich in culture. Cush is a legendary figure whom we know little about personally, but his name is left by his children all over Nubia, Ethiopia, Arabia, and even Hindu. His first five sons all settled Arabia. Little is known of Sheba. The name Sheba and Seba seem to be used interchangeably. There is a Sheba in Joktan's family, a son of Shem, and a Seba and Sheba in Ham's family. Havilah is another difficult name to decipher. There is also a Havilah in Joktan's family. Havilah was a land mentioned in the description of the Garden of Eden. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 10 and 11, we read, "And a river went out of Eden to water the garden, and from thence it was parted and became four heads. The name of the first is Pison. That is it which compasses the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold." End quote. The river Pison has not yet been identified by archaeology. Havilah is mentioned later in the Bible also. Abraham's son Ishmael dwelt near Havilah. Genesis chapter 25, verse 17 and 18 says, "And these are the years of the life of Ishmael, 137 years, and he gave up the ghost and died, and was gathered unto his people. And they dwelt from Havilah unto Shur, that is before Egypt, as thou goest towards Assyria. And he died in the presence of all his brethren." End quote. It may be the area of Central Arabia, which is said to be once a lush green oasis in ancient times. Shur is in the Sinai, before Egypt, as thou goest to Assyria. If Ishmaelites lived between Shur and Havilah, then Havilah must be between Egypt and Assyria. At this time, though, Havilah is unidentifiable. Sabta is a name associated with the Sabians of Yemen and Ethiopia. Rama is also associated with the Sabians. His two sons, Sheba and Dedan, are possibly the emergence of the Sabian trading hub at Dedan, as we looked at in episode 2. The Sabian kingdom stretched from Oman and into the Horn of Africa. These are generally the children of Cush. Nimrod is a key figure. We will discuss him separately after we finish looking at the Table of Nations. Mizraim, the second son of Ham, is the father of Egypt. The Hebrew, Aramaic, Babylonian, and Assyrian languages all call Egypt Mizraim or Mizra. Mizraim is the plural. The sons of Mizraim basically settled in Egypt and Libya. These distinct peoples were basically swallowed up by Egypt during the Ethiopian wars of the New Kingdom period, according to Josephus. The two sons of Kashluhim are highlighted here. The one son, named Philistim, is the father of the Philistines. They were one of the greatest enemies of Israel in ancient times. The Philistines built 5 main cities, the principal one being Gaza, with the other 4 in the same general area. We will detail Philistine history in a later episode. The children of Phut were generally understood to have settled in North Africa, west of Libya. The Canaanites were the only people in the Table of Nations who were given a border, or at least had their border described. In Genesis chapter 10, verse 19, we read, "And the border of the Canaanites was from Sidon, as thou comest to Gerar, unto Gaza, as thou goest unto Sodom and Gomorrah, and Admah and Zeboim, even unto Lasha." End quote. Sidon is a port city near Tyre, and Gaza is a known location. Gerar is just south of Gaza. Sodom, Gomorrah, Admah, and Zeboim are 4 of the 5 cities of the plain south of the Dead Sea, who were involved in the Battle of the 9 Kings, recorded in Genesis chapter 14. The location of Lasha is unknown, but we get the general idea that the borders of Canaan were somewhat similar to modern-day Israel's borders. No other borders are mentioned in the entire Table of Nations except the borders of Canaan. Canaan was a son of Ham, but I have put Canaan in a different color to illustrate the one son of Ham who was cursed. Sidon is, of course, the port city near Tyre. Heth is the ancient Hittites or Hethites. Next is the Amorite, who is also known as Amaru, who ventured down the Euphrates River and formed the Akkadian kingdom. The rest of the Canaanite tribes all seem to have stayed in Canaan. These tribes have not been heard of since ancient times. We will see how the Canaanite were eliminated in future episodes. And that completes the children of Ham. Now we are at the family of Shem, the Semites. First is Elam, who is a nation east of Shinar or Sumer. The Elamites, who had Susa as one of their principal cities. Assur is the forefather of Assyria, who was deified by the ancient Assyrians. Lud has been attached to Lydia, which is a later kingdom who occupied the Anatolian Peninsula. The ancient Lydians are presumed to have gotten their name from Lud. Aram are the Aramaeans. They founded the city of Damascus and the surrounding area. They also occupied land on the north side of the Euphrates River around the city of Haran. The Aramaeans were a sister nation and a gene pool for Israel, as were certain other nations whom we will discuss later. The 4 sons of Aram have some history. Uz built Damascus, according to Josephus. Hul founded Armenia, and Gether founded Bactria, which is called Afghanistan today. The book of Job takes place in the land of Uz. Arphaxad was the forefather of Abraham, and Abraham was from Ur. The genealogy given here for Arphaxad is interesting. From Eber, Arphaxad's grandson, we get the name Hebrew. There are two children born to the Hebrew, Peleg and Joktan. It is through Peleg that we trace the bloodline of Abraham and Israel. But it is Joktan's children who are highlighted here. Not much is known about Joktan or his sons. There is an ancient legend linking Joktan to the Tower of Babel. Some of his sons' names are the same as the Arabian names from Cush. Joktan's son, Uzal, is closely tied to the Yemenite city of Sana. This shows very strong ties to Arabia. Ophir is mentioned in the Bible as a place where there is much gold, but Ophir has not yet been identified. Peleg was named Peleg, which means earthquake, because in his days the earth was divided. Joktan's name means he will be diminished. This seems to show that the earth was divided and Peleg will prosper while Joktan will diminish. The earth was divided in Peleg's time. There does seem to be some division happening with the children of Joktan and the children of Cush. This chapter of Genesis is the only biblical information on Joktan. He is mentioned in a few chronologies of Israel in later books, but no further information is given on him. Whatever we are to learn about Joktan is right here in front of us. He has diminished since then. It seems he may have just been absorbed by the Sabian kingdom. We often find this use of names in the Bible, especially in the older parts of the Bible, like the book of Genesis. Every name has a meaning, and the meaning of the name is very descriptive of the person's role in the story or in life. As Peleg, being named Peleg because in his days the earth was divided. This shows us that an earthquake represents division when it's used metaphorically. The Bible makes extensive use of metaphors, so it's always helpful to pick up on metaphors when we can.